Welcome to the Into Wilderness podcast, the largest UK hunting, countryside and adventure podcast. How long have we been going for now?
It's just maybe a year and 3 months, a year, 4 months, something like that.
Come a long way in that time.
We have come a long way. It doesn't feel like a year and 4 months, I have to say.
So I'm one of your hosts, Daryl Pace,
and
the guy sitting next to me is...
Byron Pace.
There we
yes,
are.
I was going to say I'm the other half
I'm
of
the
podcast.
Half, yeah.
In case you hadn't realized, we are brothers.
Yeah.
In case that wasn't obvious with the surnames.
Yeah.
We're out every 2 weeks. We run a podcast which is mostly based around interviewing really cool people around the world.
Cooler people than us.
On all manner of topics. We've had things from really deep discussions on the introduction of lynx in the UK to interviewing Josh James and Ivan Carter and other big names like Donny Vincent. So it is broad-ranging, wide-spectrum, and global.
Yeah.
And we've got a whole array of great guests coming up in the next couple of weeks. But the next thing that we're going to be doing is going to Iwa. We're off to the big trade fair, the Iwa Outdoor Classic in Germany.
And I think we need to confirm this. We could possibly be the largest European hunting podcast, English speaking.
Yeah, well,
we need to confirm.
We need to confirm this, but we might very well be. We're keep on searching for others.
So Iwa next, then after that, Northern Shooting Show. That's where you can see us. We're going to be walking around them.
And at the Northern Shooting Show, we are going to be doing a live debate.
Yes,
podcast.
We are.
On a stand in the deer focus area, which is a new area that wasn't there last year. Not quite sure what the topic is going to be. We've pretty much picked who's going to be on the panels for both days. But as soon as we got some more details on that, we will let you know. And if we get a little some people, there's going to be a PA system, so you'll be able to stand in front and you should be able to listen to it as well as we're recording. That's the hope. So we're going to try and get maybe a little bit of public engagement as well.
Yeah, it would be really nice if people joined in on the show. And very excited about the Northern Shooting Show this year. We're speaking a lot with Richard, one of the organisers, and it's bigger and better. It was its first show last year. And it went really well. So if it's anything like last year, which we know it will be, because it's going to be bigger than last year, then it's going to be a great show.
Yeah, so that's going to be our first show of the year. Well, first game fair in the UK of the year. The Iwa doesn't really count because it's kind of a trade fair, so it's
not really
open to the general public.
And there is a possibility of our film festival film being shown at Iwa.
Oh, yes.
You know what, Iwa? Sorry. Northern Shooting Show.
Yes. Well, I think that's confirmed.
I think it is almost confirmed.
So we've just finished putting together the film, basically based around the trip that we did in Norway. For those people who have been listening to us for a while will know that we were in Norway last September, and we made a film. We're not going to really tell you anything about that because we will be releasing a trailer probably about Iwa time, so right the first week in March.
But afraid to say, you're not going to be able to see it for months unless you come to the event, the events that we say that it's going to be on, because it's actually being put into film festivals and we can't release it to the world until it's done the rounds of the film festivals or the events that we're going to.
So the first place that you will be able to see it in the UK will be on the big main screen at the Northern Shooting Show. We will bring you some more details on that, but I think it's pretty
12
much confirmed.
It's 12 minutes long.
It's 12 minutes long. But there will be a trailer out at the start of March.
So if that's a reason to go to the Northern Shooting Show, then it's a damn good reason. And I think you can get your tickets now. I think they're £10.
Yeah, they are, if I remember right.
Yeah.
Yeah, early bird tickets.
Early bird tickets. So get them now.
We've got some other interesting news. I've just got to try and find my note here so I get this right. So our sponsor, the Scottish Association for Country Sports, they are currently have arrangements with three major car brands. So this is a brilliant addition to your membership if you're looking for a new car, because for Toyota, Renault and Ford in the UK, they have discounts. So if you're not a member and you join, you'll be able to take up these discounts. If you're already a member, give them a call and they'll tell you what they are.
And I know they're not small discounts.
They're not. Some of them are huge. Yeah. And particularly Toyota, until the end of March 2017, they've got enhanced discounts. It's almost double what it was.
So. Let's put it this way. If you're not a Sachs member, and if the only reason, and it shouldn't be the only reason. It shouldn't be the only reason you join. But if you join just for the discount, it is worthwhile if you're looking to buy a brand new Hilux.
Yeah, or any other Toyota. Yeah, just because their discount, it's so large between now and the end of March. But if you want more details on that, give the Scottish Association for Country Sports office a call. They'll be able to tell you about their membership, what they do, and also about the discounts for vehicles. So, quite possible. I know that they're going to be talking about all these discounts in the latest newsletter, which is out at some point fairly soon. But this might be the first that some of the current members have heard about it. So
could be.
Did you have something else before we go over prizes?
No, I wanted to actually talk about Ivan Carter quickly.
Oh, okay.
Ivan Carter, a previous guest of ours. If you haven't listened to him, go and check him out now. We've mentioned him loads and loads. And whenever there's a discussion about Africa, trophy hunting, basically anything to do with
general
Africa.
Global conservation.
I always direct people to that podcast, especially online, because online, it's so hard to get a point across online. And only yesterday, in fact, there was someone online and they were saying they don't understand how trophy hunting can save a species or be beneficial to a species if it's in decline. And lions was what they were talking about. And they said, how can killing an animal be saving an animal? And I said, I can't explain all of this online. I don't actually have the time to write massive paragraphs. But secondly, you just can't explain it properly online. It's so hard to do it over social media. So I said, listen to this show with all the links. And then come back and talk to me. Mm-hmm. They haven't come back and talked to me yet. Maybe they're still listening.
Hopefully they'll listen. And it's a good point. We've had a massive amount of really great feedback from that show that we did with Ivan Carter, from people who have said, you know, I didn't really understand trophy hunting, but do you know what? I still wouldn't want to do it, but I get it. I get
and
why
that's the
there's
main
a
thing.
Reason for it. I mean, that particular podcast I was talking about talks about way more than just trophy hunting. But what's quite... You had it up there on your phone, Daryl, the latest video. And this is worth a shout-out because I was actually speaking to Ivan just a couple of days ago and we're due to catch up with him at the end of this week. But he's currently running a campaign and there's a video on his page to do with saving chimpanzees.
Yep, it is. I'm a little bit disappointed in the fact that I've shared this twice now and it's had almost no traction on Facebook, and I think that's heavily to do with Facebook filtering.
Yeah, I hope it is.
I hope it is. So it's Liro Chimpanzee Sanctuary, and he's trying to, his goal is to raise $60,000 for this chimpanzee. Now, the video is on our podcast page.
It's a chimpanzee sanctuary, not a single chimpanzee.
Yeah, but it's not a single chimpanzee, but they do more than just chimpanzees. They do other monkeys as well. His goal is to raise $60,000. If you watch the video, you'll understand what's going on there, largely to do with the bushmeat trade and also the capture of live babies. So what happens is people want live chimpanzees as pets. So the only way to get that is to kill the mother. And then these chimps are treated fairly badly and they go and save them.
It's pretty harrowing. I just finished watching a documentary on Netflix called Virunga just last night or the night before, which is based in Virunga National Park in the Congo. And it's a very similar story, but it's for mountain gorillas. Well, it's the last stronghold of mountain gorilla in the world. And it's pretty heart-wrenching, actually, to watch that. And this is an equally disturbing story and a cause definitely worthy of backing. I think we've already put the video, which has Ivan talking in it, on our podcast page on Into the Wilderness. So
we put it on both pages.
Yeah, so go and check that out and watch
it. We're going to put the link in the description of this show as well. And if you have... Ivan said it before, it's very hard to go to someone and, you know, he wants to raise $60,000. It's very hard to go to an individual person and go, I need $60,000 for this, this, and this. It's much easier to ask 60,000 people for $1. Mm-hmm. So if you can spare a pound or have one less pint at the pub, which is, I don't know, £3.80 now.
Yeah.
I mean, just for an example, $25 pays for looking after one chimpanzee for a month.
Mm.
So it'd be really cool if our show could look after a chimp for an entire year.
Yeah, that'd be quite cool. So what you said, $25 looks after a chimp in the sanctuary for a month?
For 1 month, yeah. Well, it's food. It looks after its food.
Well, I guess we lay down the challenge for some of our listeners.
Yeah.
Go and watch that video, though. The link will be in the podcast description. Go watch that
video. There is thousands of listeners, so I'm hoping that some people feel that they would like to donate to this.
Feel the urge.
Yeah.
We have a prize winner. So 2 weeks ago, we were here a week ago because we brought you a news podcast. As promised, we did deliver a whole array of news. Daryl and I covered it a week ago. But 2 weeks ago, we gave you the chance to win a Bushnell headlamp. I've got this the right way around. Yes, it was a Bushnell headlamp you could win 2 weeks ago. And it was an Instagram competition where you had to comment on the picture of
many people entered.
Yes, so Daryl, you've got the winner.
It is the Instagram username Gamekeeper's Wife, who is Sarah Jane Mottram.
Yes.
So get in contact with us. You've got a month. We will put it up on our Instagram as well, so you're aware of it, that you've won.
So this is about the third Bushnell headlamp that we've given away, and I think I said this before, but I actually have one that is part of my my hunting kit when I go out. And of course, we have another competition. You can win this week a Surefire G2X Pro, like mini handheld power lamp.
I thought it was the Fury that we gave away before, but
I think
it was Fury.
This is a slightly different one. Now, this one has two illumination settings, a 320 lumens and a 15 lumens. 320 is obviously the super bright, and that'll last for 2 hours on.
It's like looking into the sun. I suggest don't look into the torch.
But it will last 45 hours with the dimmer 15 lumens. It takes two of those, I think the little stubby 123A batteries. And it's got
They're even included.
Yeah, they are included. They're inside. And it's got a beam length of 180.
So don't say we're
meters.
Not good to you. We even include the batteries.
Mm. So, yeah, that is it. It's an awesome little torch, this. So definitely worth entering. And I haven't actually checked the price on this one, but the last one that we gave away, it's an expensive prize. It's like £180 or something
that.
So you're talking...
We were surprised when we went online and had a look.
But they've guaranteed for life, and they're basically bomb-proof. It's the kind of torch that you will probably end up handing down to your kids. okay, so if you want to win this... You're gonna have to enter, and are we gonna make it a Facebook competition?
Yeah, we'll do a tag a friend.
Yeah,
people seem to like that, and also because we do have this on YouTube as well. If you comment below on YouTube, you're entered into the competition. Mm. Nice and easy.
And if you are one of the, as is always the case with these, if you are one of the listeners who don't use all the social media, that's absolutely fine. Just send us an email. We don't want to exclude you from being able to win the prizes. Just send us an email.
podcast@paceproductionsuk.com. It is in the description. Send us an email and just put like competition,
podcast prize,
podcast competition, and we'll enter you as well. We don't like to exclude people.
So there you go, Surefire torch. That is how you win it.
Yep. I'm going to do one more thing before we get into our guest for today, which was a very interesting podcast. I was not there present while they were recording it, but because I edit it, I get to listen to it. Okay, so the next thing, Gary Latcham, we've met Gary once or twice before, actually. Mm-hmm.
And the last time was actually Northern Shooting Show.
I think it was
year.
Northern Shooting Show. Gary, a really nice guy, and he sends us quite a few poems, and they're really good. So it's every time that I've meant to read them out, we've always forgotten. So today is the day.
Have you got your poem voice on now?
I don't. Well, me and Byron are both suffering from extreme man flu. And I'm talking extreme. I almost coughed up a lung yesterday.
I did cough up a lung.
Yeah. Yeah. I felt like I've been down in the mines for a year or two. Okay, so it's called A Stalker's Poem. Not long now. The time is near. Soon it will be the season of the roebuck deer. Check my gear, make sure it's all here. get the correct ammo and check my camo, down to the range and check my sight. It's the first tomorrow, so bed early tonight. Up before dawn and into the wood. Now it's time to wait and see what's near. Maybe today I'll get a roebuck deer.
There you go.
Yeah, I enjoyed that.
Sophisticated.
Yeah, no, it's Gary.
We'll try and remember so that next time we can maybe bring you another poem. It's just remembering to read them out.
I know, we do get a large amount of messages. That's the main problem, is we get a lot of messages of people asking us to read things out and that. Mm. But it's been a long time coming, Gary, so very sorry that we've not managed before now, but I'm glad we managed to read one out now.
And one last thing I'm going to mention before we introduce our guest, and that is that you definitely need to go and check, if you like the podcast, which I'm hoping you do because you're listening, then you definitely need to go and check out our website, thepacebrothers.com, because on there, particularly, if you hit the blog tab, we've done a big revamp there, and there's a load more material. The whole thing's looking a bit slicker, and there's a great series of articles in there, particularly on conservation, which we're starting to build out. And we have been sharing them across social media, and they've been getting quite a lot of good traction. So it's the kind of thing that if you like the normal conversations that we have on this podcast, you're definitely going to like reading that material. It's going to be, you know, hopefully over the next year, it's going to be kind of the one-stop shop for conservation stuff. And also, if you are, you know, if you are hunters and shooters, you guys and girls probably like reading about rifle reviews and reloading and that kind of thing. We are going to have material like that on there too.
Yeah.
So don't miss out and make sure you go and check that out.
You know what we could do? I was just thinking there about Ivan Carter's thing. We could do a deal on our shop to raise a bit of money over the next 2 weeks for his chimpanzees. Because right now we give 10% of all our profits to charities. We haven't decided which ones we're going to give away, but it's sitting there in a pot. But I'm thinking over the next 2 weeks we could do something with the shop, with our T-shirts and mugs, and we could make a little bit of money for this charity.
Yeah, why don't we try and do that?
Mm-hmm.
So we're just going to do this off the top of our head right
now?
Yeah,
I think so.
Okay, so I think we'll raise the stakes here. So any T-shirts or mugs bought on our shop in the next 2 weeks, we will give 15% to this charity.
Yep.
Done. So there you go. A chance for you to give to the charities, help look after a chimp and all the other any other animals that they look after there. And you're going to get something in return. I think that's a pretty fair deal.
I think so as well.
So, yeah, if you weren't listening 2 minutes ago, you can find the shop on thepacebrothers.com.
Okay. So are we going into the guest now?
We have a guest. Okay. Now, the guest, it's an interesting podcast, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Ulrik.
We start with a wild boar story. That's near the start of a boar basically chasing him down after he's shot it with a bow.
Did you put the YouTube video when that goes out? Have you put
so
that on?
Yeah, so if you're watching on YouTube, when that starts being talked about, you'll actually get to see the video of
it.
Crazy. And it's you get it explained to you, but he shoots this wild boar with a recurve bow, and you can see it's almost dead on its feet. But it's the last instinct. It charges him and knocks him over, and he shouts at it, and then it has another little charge at him, and then it just drops. It falls over straight away and dies. Incredible piece of footage. Great story to listen to. Those are the kind of things you got to expect today.
Yeah. I was sitting in the office the other day, and I could hear this like repeated shouting on. I said, "Daryl, what are you watching?" He said, "I'm watching the boar charge."
Got like 80,000 views on YouTube.
Yeah, it's crazy. Well, so our guest this week is Ulrik Oskov. He is a Danish hunter.
He might not sound Danish.
No, he doesn't, because he has I think he won't mind me saying he has a really screwed up accent.
It's a confusion of like New Zealand, yeah. Aussie, and then
a
bit of Danish thrown in there as well.
But yeah, he is a guy who really embodies what it is to be a true hunter. He is hard. He is hard as nails, and he experiences hunting probably as close to the truest that you can do in the modern world. And you'll get that feeling when you watch his stuff and you read his stories and you hear what he's got to say, and just the sheer amount of time that he spent by himself out hunting in the mountains is quite incredible. So I'm pretty confident everybody's going to enjoy his stories, and definitely go and check out his Facebook page once you're done.
Oh yeah, best of all, you do find this out later on. He's a vet student. He must be in his, one of his final years now, as he was in the middle.
I think he spent a lot of time hunting.
Yeah, I know. He spent too much time hunting. Because the last picture, one of the last pictures he put up on Instagram was him doing an operation on a dog.
Mm, yeah.
So he is a vet student as well, which is an interesting thing to learn
about.
We
talk about that.
We do talk about how, on one hand, you can be saving animals' lives all day, and then in your evenings, you're hunting animals. Mm. So it's...
interesting dynamic.
It is an interesting dynamic.
We hope you enjoy the show. Ulrik, thank you for joining us on the Into the Wilderness podcast. It's awesome to have you on. I know we've been talking over the last couple of weeks, and finally it's here. Now, we first met, for those people who don't know, I can't remember how many years ago it was, but it must have been like 3-4 years ago.
Yeah,
at a big event over in Denmark, and then we've talked on and off from time to time, and we've got a mutual friend in David CP, who's the only person, the only guest on the podcast who's actually been on more than once.
Yeah,
and he wants to come on again. I don't know why.
How good is that? No, you thank you for having me, and no, it's a great podcast. I think that's why David wants to come on again. You've had quite a few good people on the show, and I'm honored to be on here.
No, it's cool to have you here, and people will realize this as we start to talk, but what's going to be nice is, as well as being a rifle shooter, one of your big passions is bow hunting. Now, David talked about bow hunting, we've had Donnie Vincent talk about bow hunting, so that's this will be the third person, which in the UK we can't do it here. So that's going to be an interesting take, and despite the fact that we can't do it here, I've been quite heartened by the response that we've had from like our UK listeners, where I thought it might kind of turn them off, but they've actually been really intrigued as to what you bow hunters have had to say.
Yeah, well, I can say that I haven't done much bow hunting in Denmark, so I mean, for you to be located in the UK and you'd be able to do pretty much as much bow hunting as I've done. I think the only thing I shot in Denmark is a hare, really. So
really?
I mean, there's unlimited options in New Zealand if you're ready to work for it.
Yeah.
And not only New Zealand but Australia too, which is where I've done probably most of my bow hunting.
Yeah. Let's start with that. So because I'd had actually seen them before. You sent me a couple of links of stuff to watch before we did the podcast, but I had watched them all before, but I just watched them all again last night. Let's just start with this, because we'll put this up for the people who watch us on YouTube, and I'll put the links for your original video in the description of the podcast. Let's talk about that boar. Charged as you just explain that whole scenario, like in infinite detail, if you like, because it's something a lot of people will never experience.
It is a good clip, and I'm so grateful to have that captured on GoPro, because it's just something that after it happens, after you being charged, you can't really remember what really happened. Did I go on my ass 3-4 times? What happened? So it's just it's good to have. And no, I was out hunting on a private bit of property, Adam Green Tree, and I was actually chasing fallow bucks, and I'd spent a whole lot of time, trying to get the drop on one, but they were just so hard, and all of a sudden I just couldn't find them, and there he was. I could just see him lying, the bull, probably 600 meters away, sort of thing. And I could, from that point, I could actually tell he had big tusks, So I was like, fuck, if I can see the tusks from here, he's got to be a massive boar. And I was like, righto, I'm going to give up on the fallow and just hit for him, And so I actually, because the wind was good and he was sleeping, I made sort of a dash, real quick to just got down there and snuck in slowly. And, I think at that point in time, I was just, what I had to focus on was just not getting too excited, which is always the hard part in bow hunting, which is actually the hardest part in bow hunting, especially I think with the recurve, when you don't have the sights on, you've got to be mentally, you've got to be just, calm and focused and not let the adrenaline, let that buck fever or whatever you want to call it, not let that take over. So That's actually what I find to be the hardest part. Anyway, as I get closer to this boar, and I can tell he's just still lying sleeping. His ears are moving around, so he's still sort of his half there, you know. And I just get into probably 15 meters, and I'm like, I'm not going to go any closer. This is perfect shooting range for me. And I just stare at the crease, right? He's quartering away a bit, and that's perfect when you want to stick a pig. And I just zoom in, focus on the spot, draw back, and I just, you know, do the drill. And, yeah, it just hammers him perfect straight up the heart, and I knew he was hit perfect, you know. I knew it was like, oh, I just relaxed after having that arrow sink into him. I was like, oh, he's done, you know. It's 10 seconds, and it's going to be over. And then I relaxed my bow hand, which is the mistake I made, really. If I would have stood still, I don't think he would have come charging. So he picked the movement, took the bow down, and he picked the movement instantly, and he just came charging, you know. And, yeah, I think what happened was I knew 10 seconds, you know. You just got to do, Rick, you got to do 10 seconds, and that's it. He's going to be done, which is why I didn't. Maybe if it would have been a bad shot, I maybe would have started running, but I knew it was a good shot, and you can't run from the pigs anyways.
No.
So, I was just thinking, I was seeing it in my mind over and over, like how I was just going to kick him in the face, and that's what I did, you know. I planned it, just put up the foot and let him run into it, you know. And that worked perfect. I went down on my ass, got back up again real quick, and he came at me again, and he tried to hook me this time, you know, bringing his head backwards. But I hit him in the face again, and that was it. And then he just started feeling dizzy, you know, because he'd just been dashing, you know, 15 meters, and that would have got his blood pumping, and then he just couldn't do anymore. He backed off, and then he's just stood, you know, clamping his, you know, his jaws, and yeah, I think the adrenaline, and then he just dropped, and
he was dead on his feet.
He was dead on his feet, and he would have gone down a lot sooner if he hadn't picked my movement.
Yeah,
he would have been dead in 10 seconds. This last, he was like on his feet for probably 30 seconds this time, but yeah.
I mean, had you, you've seen plenty of boar, and you know, over in Europe, the boar is a big thing. Had you had it in your mind prior to taking the shot, or when you were very first going after boar with a bow, that you would tackle it in that way if you were confronted, that you would have to tackle it head on as opposed to try and, you know, dodging it? But I mean, I think what you did there, basically putting a piece of your body, which was your foot, between yourself and where the pig was, to kind of push it off the line, if you were, because you were in open ground. I mean, I don't think there was any other way to do it other than what you did.
No, I don't think so either. I think, well, there could have been, but no. I hadn't seen any boar attacks. I haven't been hunting boars in Europe, really, before this. I've had stories down in – this was my second time in Australia, so I'd hunted pigs the year before, and shot a few pigs the year before as well. And I'd heard stories of boars charging, you know, but they were like, I asked, how frequently does it happen? And it's something like 1% to 2% of when you shoot a boar that they will charge. So it's not very frequent, and when it happens, you just got to jump up a tree or whatever, but this was not the case, you know, no trees, nothing. And I heard the story of my good friend Adam and Antonio going out to track down a wounded pig, and they were just walking along, and they had the bows on their back, or Antonio did anyways, and Antonio, all of a sudden, this boar just comes charging out of the scrub towards Antonio and puts him on the ground in an instant, like this boar did to me. And what happened was Antonio put his feet up as well while he was laying down. He wasn't standing up, and the boar just kept going at him, and it ended up, the tusk ended up going through his leather boot into his, you know, into his leg.
Mm.
As well as ripping up his calf muscle. And Adam was just, this is the funniest thing. And I'm so like, why don't you carry a freaking GoPro, Adam? You would have so much crazy stuff on video, you know. But Adam came charging. He took an arrow out of his quiver, and he just came charging at that pig and jumped on its back and yelled, come at me, you f***ing c***. and he just stabbed it with this arrow and just repeatedly. And it was, yeah.
That's raw.
Crazy story, yeah.
That's and just so doing what you need to survive.
He ended up stabbing that pig to death with an arrow.
Wow.
Yeah, that's pretty primal.
I mean, but, you know, if you were to isolate that little story that you just said, right, without any context, it would sound terrible to somebody outside the hunting world particularly. But in that situation, what do you do? Because, I mean, for those people who don't know much about, well, just pigs in general, any kind of pigs, whether it's feral pigs or whether it's wild boar,
yeah,
they will take you out and they will kill you if you don't take some sort of action. And every year with the bush pigs in Africa, which is probably most of my experiences with pigs is with bush pigs in Africa, every year they kill somebody out there.
Yeah.
Hunting them. Yeah. I mean, every year at least one person
dies. They're those mangy ones, aren't they? What?
I mean, yeah, they're not too, but, no, they're not that bad. I mean, they're full of lice, quite a lot of them.
Okay. Yeah.
But they, I'm trying to think what they, I suppose they kind of look like a wild boar, but they don't have as much sort of hair and stuff on them.
Yeah, they've got big, big sort of weird heads, don't they?
Yeah, and they've got like a lot, the boars have big warts on them, like big stick-up
warts. Yeah, they're the ones. Yeah, they're
and,
the ones.
I mean, it's sort of a fantastic animal to hunt, but I mean, they do a serious amount of damage to not only crops, but also they just wipe out lambs. If you got sheep and you got wild boar there, they're like worse than foxes and jackal. Yeah. they can do some serious damage, which is why they hunt them. They hunt a lot of them with dogs there, up really close. They do. I think they do a bit of it in New Zealand, although I've never done it with I think they do them with dogs as well, and actually with spears or knives. Have you heard of that or seen it?
Yeah, I've done hunting with knives and dogs as well, but it's not. Well, it's an adrenaline rush, but it's not. I don't. Well, it's a good hunt, anyways. I don't fancy it that much now. Like,
no. I don't know if I got the balls for it, to be honest.
Well, it is good hunting, but I mean the pig. You know, the dogs grab onto the pig for a while, and it's not really. I like the silent kill. You know, I like to sneak in, stick it with an arrow, and he's going to turn around, not knowing what happened, and then he's just going to drop. You know.
Yeah. The proximity that you're, I mean, that was the other thing I was going to say when you were talking about, when you were sort of in the thrust of describing your charge, is the proximity when you're bow hunting, especially with a recurve, is it's right there. It's like at the end of your nose. You don't have that kind of safety gap that you could have with a rifle if you so choose. You're shooting something at 100 meters. It's very unlikely something's going to make the dash.
Yeah.
Even if it does see you.
Yeah.
So it's it's a totally
different thing. For you close up and no, it's yeah, it is an exciting type of hunting, and it really gets under your skin once you get the hang of it, you know, because in the beginning it was really hard. The hardest part was, you know, keeping that excitement away before the shot, and you really have to teach yourself how to control your excitement. That was really the hardest part. In the beginning, I couldn't, and I missed that 10 meters, you know, and it was like really frustrating.
And it's not because you couldn't shoot. It was everything else overtaking your ability.
Yeah, exactly. But then I got the hang of it, and I was able to, I started being able to more sort of control the excitement and let it loose after the shot, you know. And then I hit the excitement after the shot, which is what you want when you bow hunt. Like with the rifle, you can be excited before the shot as well, because you can tell the crosshairs if you're ready or not to shoot. You know, it's just different with the recurve. Yeah,
maybe we should talk about that now, because it's I think both the bow hunters we've had on before, who I mentioned, David and Donnie, both shoot with. Well, I'm sure they both have shot recurves, but most of the stuff you see them doing is with compound bows.
Yeah.
So, which is in a way, and I shoot a recurve for fun here, but I haven't hunted with it. I'm not good enough yet. I've never shot a compound bow. But from what my understanding of it is, it's a little bit closer towards shooting with a scoped rifle, if you like, because you do have that sight set up. Whereas the recurve's a lot more instinctive. So, for those people who don't know, just explain that difference and the difference when it comes to actually, you know, training, practicing, and out in the field hunting, because I think that's going to tie in quite nicely with what you're saying about getting in sort of control of your emotions prior to letting loose.
Yeah. I mean, the big difference is that I haven't hunted with a compound. I've only shot it like probably 15, 20 times tops, you know, and I wouldn't mind hunting with a compound either. It's different, but How can I say it? I mean, yeah, you just got to, in both the compound and the recurve, you've got to be mentally stable. So there's not much difference in that, you know, with the compound and recurve. And you can even, people don't always shoot instinctive with the recurve or longbow either. Some people use like gap shooting, like aiming with the tip of the arrow.
Okay.
So you can do that as well. So I don't see, well, there is a difference, but the difference is probably more like repetition. Like, and I actually like that. I like that you don't have to, okay, so this is the big difference, I think. I like the fact that you don't have to aim at something, that you don't have to, that I can just look at where I want to hit and just put it straight there, you know. That is the best feeling I know, man. You know, just being able to look at it and not think of anything else than just looking at it and just doing your routine, and then it's just there, you know. It makes for, so the recurve does have an advantage, which is the movement. You don't have the same movement as the compound, and you don't have to wait for as long. It all depends on what your routine is, you know, your shooting cycle. You don't have to wait for as long as with the compound. You don't have to think of the yardage. I don't have to think, is this 10 meters or is it 25 meters? I can just zoom in on the point, and it's just going to be like a basketball player, you know, looking at the basket and just sinking the ball in. So I reckon that's the biggest difference, that you don't have to carry a rangefinder. You don't have to think of the distance. You can just do it. And I mean, I'm not shooting further than, you know, 22, 25 tops at the moment. And so there's not much difference in the trajectory anyways.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it's just a matter of practicing a lot. And
I was going to say that the one caveat to everything you just said, though, was that you probably have to practice a shed load more.
Oh, you do, man. And I have to stay on, because your muscles, even the muscles that you pull your bow with, they sort of disappear within a week, you know. You can feel that you haven't been shooting, and you just got to get back into it.
So how many arrows are you shooting a day when you're in sort of full flight and you know you're going to be hunting?
Actually, and that's sort of the problem as well when I got to New Zealand, is I when I'm hunting, I don't really practice that much. I keep a practice head and I shoot, I just stump shoot, or what do you want to call it, just shoot in the ground just to keep the shape up. But I shoot more when I'm preparing for a hunt, and then I don't shoot a lot when I'm actually hunting. I shoot a few arrows in the morning usually before going out, just to, and that's enough. Like if I just keep it up with a couple arrows a day, it's enough to keep me sort of in shape.
Cool.
Yeah. But yeah, it's definitely different than the compound, whereas you can just wait for, you know, you could wait a couple months and take 10 arrows and you'd be sort of dialed in if you're in good shape.
Yeah, I suppose it's a little bit more like shooting a rifle. You know, once you've done it and, you know, your sights are set up, if nothing's changed, then
yeah,
you should probably take a couple of shots just to make sure everything's good, but it doesn't require the repetitive daily training of a recurve. I think that's what probably excites me about it. And, you know, hopefully another 12 months of shooting and I might be able to actually go hunt with it. Obviously not here in this country, but somewhere else.
Yeah, I'll definitely, I'll point you into some good spots in New Zealand and or Australia.
Yeah, we'll have to do
Does
that.
Does it matter?
Or go together. Hey, there's
an
idea.
Yeah, definitely. How good would that be? Get a bit of footage, bit of filming, and yeah.
Now, normally when we start these podcasts, I normally start by getting a bit of background of the person, but I was so excited to talk about the boar, we kind of skipped that. So I think now's a good time to do that. Now, it might seem strange to some people, especially those, we have quite a few people who listen to the podcast who are not necessarily like big hunters and, you know, not necessarily fishermen, but they like the countryside, so they like the debate and like to be able to take different things from different people. Yep. So when I tell them that you are a vet student and you're a hunter, that may seem to some people like two things that don't really go together. But so we're going to tackle that. But before we get to that bit, which is kind of where you are right now, tell me a little bit about your early off, because I actually don't really know a huge amount about it, and where your passion for hunting came from.
Well, I grew up, my granddad and grandma on my dad's side, they had a farm out west, and I used to spend a lot of time there running around with the neighbor boy, and we used to, you know, build our own arrows and hunt with our own bows, you know, pretend to hunt sort of thing, and just run around the field catching mice, and it was just an awesome place. They had sheep, they had pigs, you know, there's just all sorts of animal life, and we had the forest to ourselves. And my granddad was a hunter. He unfortunately passed away when I was 5-6 years old. So I don't remember much. I remember being on a hunt with him where he shot a fox. Not much more, but I had some awesome times out there, and I think that's sort of what kick-started, because I think it's really in the DNA. Like, I heard a lot of people say that, you know, the hunters, it's in the blood, you know. Mm-hmm. It's something that I think it's in within a lot of people. But I think it's maybe stronger in other people, in some people, of course. But I think this kick-started it and kept it going. And, so we just – but even from an early age, like my mom told me not long ago, when I was 2 years old and I started walking, I climbed out in the the chook yard. And there was this chook on a pin, and I had crawled up on it. And I was sidling towards it, and my mom was like, "Am I gonna have to take him down?" But she was fearing that chook was gonna pick out my eye or something. You know? I just kept creeping towards that chook, and the chook was just leaning towards the wall and just getting more and more, you know, sketchy. And I came closer, and just all of a sudden, I just had the chook in my hand, you know, 2 years old, and I just stood there with the chook holding it. So I think it's been in my genes, you know. I think it's been in there for a while, you know.
That primal urge.
It's pretty deep.
I mean, I totally agree with you. I think that if most people were put in the right situation, they would find what's potentially missing, which is exactly as you've explained. Yeah, that urge. Because, I mean, ultimately, we all consume the end result of that urge, but we don't necessarily have to do it because we have the conveniences of shops, basically, and modern agriculture. But you take it back and you strip it back, and we're going to talk about, you know, your time in New Zealand soon, and then you really find out who you are, I think.
Yeah.
So yeah. So from that into sort of your later years, sort of leaving school and stuff, and then deciding what you were going to do, what was your sort of thought process for deciding to do what you're currently doing now?
Was it vet studies you're thinking?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, your vet studies, yeah.
Well, when I realised that was at the age of 10, I realised sort of I can't probably go be a, you know, live as an Indian,
which as much is as what you
I
want wanted
to do at the time, actually. Yeah. And I just realised, okay, I probably can't make a living of being an Indian. Vet was actually the first thing that just came up because I love animals too, you know. And so it sort of came natural, and it sort of just stuck with me and went with the flow. Nothing changed, and yeah, I didn't have the grades to go in the first quota. The studies are sort of broken up into two parts where you get the first quota, the people with the highest grades, and then the second half, 90 people go in with through a test and then through a conversation with people or with the examinators, and you talk a bit about why you want to be a vet and whatnot. And yeah, I got in that way, and it's just been a blast. It's just been an absolute blast. I've been loving it here, and I've been trying to sort of extend my time studying because I love just being here. I'm living like basically at the university. I've got 2 minutes to go to classes and stuff, and it's just perfect. I live in a dorm with 8 people in the same hall, and it's just an amazing time I'm having here.
You just said just a moment ago, you know, you love animals. I mean, I totally understand that, but can you just elaborate on that a little bit more and tie that to your hunting? Because again, it seems it could seem, especially from people outside of the hunting world, that just seems like a ridiculous contradiction, where you can be fascinated and, you know, love just seeing, you know, animals out in the wild, as we all do, but yeah, there you are putting an arrow through something. So I mean, I understand it, but I want to hear what your kind of mindset is for that, so other people can hear.
I think it's just, it comes so natural to me that it's hard to I find it maybe a bit hard to explain, but everybody loves animals. There's no one that hates animals, you know, I don't think. But it's just the hunting part is so integrated into me that it's just such a big part of me, and it's something that's natural. It's just who we are, really. And I think, and it's been like that for ages, you know. It's only recently that we sort of started, you know, farming animals and not having to hunt it. So I find it more natural not to or to be able to kill an animal and still love it, you know. Yeah, it is complicated probably to explain to people that haven't had their hunting and maybe they don't have it, the hunting instinct, you know.
I wonder over a long enough time horizon, you know, if we continue the way that sort of society and that is, which I imagine we probably will, whether the same way that you can breed certain traits in animals if you want to do that, and we have done that through agriculture, whether as humans we will actually lose it, or some people will actually lose it.
I've thought of it a lot. I mean, yeah, that could happen, and yeah, it could. I don't know.
Yeah. No, I don't know. It was one of these hypothetical things. I just thought of it while you were talking about that.
Yeah, yeah. No.
Okay. You recently spent a bit of time out in New Zealand. You've been over twice, have you?
Yeah, twice. Actually, three times. First time wasn't hunting. It was just with family. But, yeah, I was there in 2012 with Espen. The first time, and we hunted with the rifles, and that was actually part of that was not only for the hunting for me, it was also to get some experience before getting into the vet studies. So I sort of did that as well. You know, we worked on farms and that, and then we went hunting as well, and that's sort of where I wanted to go as well, because I couldn't get into rifle hunting here at home because it's so expensive as well. And New Zealand was the perfect place to do it, and that's actually also where the bow thing sort of kicked off for me, because Espen brought his compound bow to New Zealand and hunted both with the compound and the rifle down there. And we had an awesome time in New Zealand in 2012. We ended up shooting both big stags, big tar, and chamois as well. So that was an epic trip, and you couldn't ask for more. And that just got me hooked on New Zealand, you know, for life. And there's just something about New Zealand, you know, the big terrain and such different terrain as well. And the people there, it's just an amazing country.
Yeah, I haven't had the opportunity to – well, I have had the opportunities to go, but I haven't had the time to go yet. But my cousin actually lives there now. He was my old
– Where's he living?
He lives in the south of the North Island somewhere. I can't remember exactly where he lives. He's a doctor over there, actually. And growing up, when I was a kid, he was my big hunting fishing buddy, because he lived like 30 minutes from me here. So we were, you know, even before either of us could drive – we were fishing as far away as we could, and then as soon as we got driving licenses, we would just fish around all of Scotland. And then we did more fishing then than we were hunting, but we would hunt together as well.
Awesome. I actually did that when I was younger too. Like, I did a lot of fishing, but now nothing.
Likewise, actually. But that's just because of, sadly, just bloody time. I still love to fish, but I suppose when you're younger, fishing is way more accessible than being able to go out hunting. So I guess that's probably why a lot of us, and it is. I always view it as it is hunting. It is hunting with a hook. It's the same thing, you know. It's like spot and stalk, especially, and that's what I love to do in clear rivers.
You got to try underwater, you know, spearfishing.
My brother's done it, and he loves it. Yeah.
Oh yeah, I saw that on the video. Mm. Yeah. No, that's awesome.
Yeah. So obviously this. I don't know how I got off on that tangent, but anyway. Obviously, that first experience in New Zealand is what drove you to this your more recent trip there. And you did a whole, but just from, I know I saw you in Denmark whenever it was, 2 months ago or something. And just from the little bit that we talked about there and the bits and pieces I've seen and different conversations we've had, I mean, you did a whole ton of stuff there. But the thing I want to start with is, and I think the first part of the video is on YouTube, if I'm not mistaken, where you shoot the Samber hind.
Yeah.
So that, I think it is very rare. In fact, I don't know, quite honestly, whether I've ever seen it captured, certainly, on film that level of honest emotion.
Yeah.
I mean, you see, I mean, quite frankly, you know, you see there's a lot of bullshit out there, you know, with stuff that's captured on film from around the world, where I feel like it's too much of a celebration for their own egos, individuals' own egos, than it is the raw emotion and celebration of what's happened. And I think, and again, we'll stick the link for people to see this, that what you see there with you, I mean, it's just, it's perfect. It's beautifully perfect.
I hadn't imagined it being that emotional. It just rolled me over.
So let's start from the beginning. We'll get to that. We'll try and describe it for those people who aren't going to click the link. But let's start at the beginning of the... Am I right in thinking that was, you'd spent like 2 days in the tent because it was chucking it down with rain?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll talk about your other stuff in New Zealand, but let's just start with that particular hunt and what it was like sitting in a tent by yourself for 2 days.
Well, yeah, I got to build it up more because it's not only the 2 days.
Because
I came from New Zealand and I'd been hunting. I'm just going to do it briefly. I was hunting tar. I didn't get a tar even though I got close like four times. I got into 13 to 17 meters four times on tar and I didn't send one arrow. And it was frustrating. I ended up mucking it and then David came down to New Zealand and we hunted for 3 weeks with the camera guy and did a production on that and it's going to air on telly sometime soon. But we hunted for 3 weeks, the red stags. We never let an arrow go on the stags. We shot a tar with the rifle and David shot a goat with a bow. But we never got the stag. And then I went to Australia and I hunted the fallow deer and it was horrible conditions. The ground was just dry and it was hot. Not Australian wise hot, but it was hot for me, you know. And it was just horrible. And so I thought, what am I going to do? And I was just thinking to go down south because conditions were looking better. And I wrote this guy, Carl Brown. He's called Captain Bowman on YouTube. You should really look him up because he's got a lot of good footage there. Anyways, I've been talking to Carl Brown before and had a few chats with him and I wrote him and asked him if he was able to point me in direction of somewhere to hunt somebody on public land and he was like, do you have a four-wheel drive or two-wheel drive? And I was like, I've only got a two-wheel drive. But and then he said, you won't get far. And I asked him if he was able to drop me off somewhere and if I could pay him to drop me off and pick me up like a week later or something, and he said that I could just come down and we could go for a hunt and we should be able to sort something out. And I just went down, drove 10 hours and got down to Captain late night and we had a talk and we ended up going hunting for a few days. And I actually ended up staying in his camper van by his house like on and off for 6-7 weeks staying with his family, and that was just unreal, you know. Hooked up on YouTube and Facebook, and then
it's an amazing community, the hunting community.
It is There's so many options there, but anyways, we hunted a lot together. I missed a fallow buck and it was killing me, and it was sort of it wasn't a real opportunity. He was walking and I'd imagine that the fallow buck would stop and we called him in, the fallow deer, and he didn't stop. He just kept walking, and I had branches in front of him, couldn't shoot, and he was just sort of starting to pace up a bit, and he was 30 meters away, and I just sent away a horrible arrow just straight over his back, and I was like, what the freaking hell are you doing, you know? But it was just so frustrating for me at the moment, not having hunted for so long and not having, you know, taken down a deer, and it was just, yeah.
So what period of time are we talking at this point? How long had you been away from home?
So I've been hunting tar for 2 weeks. 3 weeks in New Zealand, hunting stags for 3 weeks in New Zealand, hunting fallow deer for a week and a half in Australia, and now we're here, you know, still hunting these fallow, and then we started hunting Samber deer, and then we hunted probably for 7 days, 5 days, something, and we went hunting for goats, and I was like, I need to get something on the ground. I need to boost my confidence. So we went hunting for some really switched-on goats on a mountainside. And we ended up in the afternoon, I ended up killing a goat and he caught it on film, which is in the film as well.
Yeah, you know, I saw that, yeah.
Yeah, that shot. And that was awesome. Finally to get something on the ground, get some meat. And then he dropped me in the bush with the meat and a lot of gear, and I just stayed out there to hunt the sandbar, to really focus, because what we've been doing is driving back and forth, you know, in the morning, going back at night, and I just wanted to be there at first light, you know, and really just focus on my own, and because sometimes that just works better, you know, especially, yeah, sometimes it just works better hunting alone, and sometimes it works better hunting two guys, but anyways, I started hunting on my own then, and then it just started pissing down, and I was locked down in the tent, you know. It was actually good, though, having that time in the tent, because I, you know, I spent probably 35 hours in the tent only going out when I had to take a dump, you know. And, yeah, so it was good. It was relaxing. And then I got a bit wet one night, had to dry out, and then it just cleared that morning, and it was only dripping, so conditions were just perfect, absolutely perfect. Wind in the trees, so the sandbar the deer wouldn't hear a lot, and the ground was soft, you know. And I'd looked at the map and I knew where I was going, and I just thought I'd just cross that gully, but when I got to it, I could just tell straight away that it was a good gully, you know. And because it was out of the wind and had a lot of feed and cover down in the bottom, so I just snuck down. The wind was perfect, and got down, and all of a sudden I could just I spotted that was the first thing I spotted, you know, 5-6 kangaroos.
Oh, yeah.
Feeding, and I thought, okay, it is a good spot. I mean, where the kangaroos feed, Samber might feed as well, you know. And I snuck up and I stood by a tree, and the roos were probably 30 metres away, and I just stood there looking at the roos, and I'd probably been standing there for 5-10 minutes sort of thing, and all of a sudden this sandbar hind just comes walking down slowly from the opposite side, and I was like, ah, my heart just started pumping. I was like, how unreal is this? The sandbar just had no idea, and it just came down perfect, reached the bottom, and then just sort of started walking towards me and looking up, and then it looked up towards me and sort of went a bit broadside, but it was still looking at me, looking away. And at this time it's only like 15 meters away, and it comes even a few steps closer, so it ends up being like 10 meters away from me. And by that time I had the bow right up in front of me and sort of drawn to like a quarter out, some sort of thing. And as she turned more broadside, she was still quartering on, but then I just drew back, and I didn't draw fully back because I think she might have picked the movement, but I drew back and I just let the arrow fly, and it just straight, I found out that it sort of nicked the heart, the bottom of the heart. It didn't, so I took out the right lung, and she just sprinted away and ran up into some cover, and I just started, oh shit, you know, I knew it was a good shot, but, and then it just, took up the binos, tried to spot her out of there, and I thought I could see her, but I wasn't really too sure. And then I got more and more confident that I could actually see her, and that she was lying down, you know, and I just started crying and I just couldn't help it, man. It just took over.
It's just fantastic. As I said before you started the story, it's rare that I've seen honest emotion like that captured on film. I mean, it was beautiful to watch, because because I think, yeah, if you combine it with the fact that, and this is something I want to talk about, is sort of the kind of the trophy hunting question. I mean, this was a female deer, so there's no in inverted commas trophy, but you know, this was the hunt for you, the actual, you correct me if I'm wrong, but the actual hunt that you just did there, and releasing the arrow and the success there, that was your trophy.
Mate, absolutely. This is definitely the biggest hunting experience I've ever had. Definitely. Because that was just because I'd been so, yeah, just so devastated that I'd just been going for so long without getting anything, you know, or getting a deer in it. Yeah, it was overwhelming, man. Overwhelming.
Fantastic. And look, we'll, I hope that people are intrigued enough to go and click the link in the description for this, because you got to see it. It's almost impossible to describe this, but just, yeah, go click the link, because it's fantastic to watch. And yeah, it especially, you know what, especially if you're someone who doesn't hunt, go and watch that and see the reaction of a hunter to, you know, what they've just done. It's fantastic. Yeah. So what was the end result of that? You had successfully killed it.
Yeah. What happened was I stood there looking at it, but all of a sudden she started moving again. And I was like, no, you've got to be freaking joking. I thought she was dead, you know. But at the same time, I was in doubt. Before that, I was in doubt if she was dead or not, which is why I just sat back, you know, and watched her. She went down. She walked probably 50 meters, and I was looking at her the whole time, just standing still, staying out of the wind, and she ended up going down to a wallow, and she ended up dying there probably 10 minutes after. So it sort of took like 15 minutes, I think, 20 minutes for her to die. And that was horrible. That's the only thing about this hunt that I hate, that it had to go down that way, because usually they die within 10 seconds, you know. So this was horrible. But, you know, seeing in perspective to what happens, how other people get the meat, and knowing that this animal has lived its whole life in the wild, you know, it makes it kind of a right, I think, for me. I mean, I don't feel as guilty.
I think it's important that you explained that, though, because, well, one, it's a very honest thing for you to tell that story, because it doesn't go 100% right 100% of the time. But also your reaction to that, it is horrible when things don't go 100% right.
Yeah.
But you have to deal with that and be comfortable with it yourself.
Yeah. It pushes you as well to, you know, to keep improving.
Absolutely, yeah.
It happened the way it happened, and yeah, having everything in perspective, I think I don't find it okay, but I think other people go to the supermarket, buy meat, and the pigs have lived their whole life in a freaking cage, you know, and yeah. So anyways, that's another discussion, but it was a good hunt, and she ended up dying there in the wallow, and I went down, and yeah, it was crazy, and I went out and got some signal, called the captain, and he couldn't believe that. He didn't really actually believe, I don't think. Well, he was in disbelief anyways, and we went, and he was just as stoked as I was, man. He was pumped. So we went down, got all the meat off it, and got it out. Carved it up with his old man, and put it in the freezer in the fridge, and ate it the next morning, ate it the same night, and yeah, very, very good meat. So yeah, the whole cycle is there, you know, hunting it, eating it, and it just comes natural. Once you've done it a few times, it's just natural to you, you know, go finding your own animal and eating it.
You are one of them at the end of the day when you do it on that level.
You become part of it. And, you do. Yeah, I love it.
So what were there any, I mean, that was obviously like a massive highlight of that trip. I don't know how much you can talk about what you did with David. Can you give any the stuff's coming out soon, can you give kind of any insight as to what you guys were doing there with David?
Well, we were doing a documentary on bow hunting, red stags in New Zealand, and I'd sort of planned out a few spots that we were going to go and talk to a few people, and we needed to do a commercial for SICE as well, which was part of the deal, because SICE and Sitka sort of sponsored the camera guy to go there and produce the film. And, so we did that. We hunted goats for a beginning. I wanted to get some meat on the table for a kickoff if we ended up not getting a stag, which was the case. So, so we got a few kills, didn't get the stag, but that's what happens. I mean, I like, actually, after looking back, I think it's also a good thing that we didn't get a stag, because that would send the signal that you can just go down and kill a stag with a bow in New Zealand. This way, you know, you might not get a stag. Even though you fight for 3 weeks, you might not get your stag. And that's an important signal to sell, because right now New Zealand is being sold off, or it's getting quite a bit of a hype, New Zealand, at least. But it's you have to fight your ass off to get things done there if you're hunting public land. It's a different thing when you're hunting private land with a guide, but hunting public land is not as easy, even with a rifle, as you might, you know, have heard of. So I just had two guys from, is it Switzerland or Austria? I think it's, not too sure, but they went down anyways and rented, or took my car down in New Zealand and drove around for 3 weeks, and they didn't shoot an animal. and they're experienced hunters. So it's all about knowing the area. I mean, to be successful, you've got to find the area with game, and then if you don't, you're just out of luck, and yeah, it makes it hard for you. And that's the way New Zealand is, public land. It's, you never know. Populations change quickly, and you've got the poisonous droppings as well, 1080, that just wipe out deer populations absolutely for 5 years, you know, before any deer starts appearing again. And yeah, so it is a bit, you need to do a bit of groundwork before you go hunting in New Zealand, and then you need to be fit, you need to know the right tactics. So not an easy mission, but definitely satisfying once it happens.
I think you mentioned being fit there. I think you are absolutely right. I'm David, he's probably going to kick me for saying this, but I'm sure he admitted to me that he wishes he'd been slightly fitter when he arrived in New Zealand. Was that apparent?
Well, it's always apparent if you're not in top shape.
Yeah.
I mean, these are steep as freaking hell mountains, you know. It's not easy. But if you're at a decent level of fitness, I mean, it's going to be a week
you gain
walking,
it.
and you'll be there, you know. Bring your hill stick, and it's going to work out fine. I mean, more than shape, it's also the grit. I mean, if you've got the mentality to just push on, it doesn't matter. You don't have to be peak fitness.
Mm.
It's definitely going to help you, but if you're mentally strong, I mean, you can push. You can do a lot of things.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. It's like that in life, isn't it?
And David is mentally strong, so that worked out well. I mean, it wasn't a problem. It just
toughed it out.
It was only the first trip we did, really, where he was. So that's only normal. No, he was doing a really good job, David, and the camera guy as well. I mean,
yeah, you forget about the camera guy. Some people forget. Yeah. I don't forget about the camera guy because I do so much of it. But
yeah,
people forget about the camera guy. Everywhere those hunters or whoever it is goes, the camera guy's there following. So he's had to do exactly, he or she's had to do exactly the same stuff.
Martin did an absolutely great job. He was not, you know, complaining at one single time. He just went through wet and tight shit, you know. Yeah, no, it was awesome. Awesome adventure, even though we didn't get the stag. I mean, it just, now I know, because we saw big stags and I was so close. I was at full draw, man, and this stag just cycled behind me to get the wind, and he got the wind and he just took off, and I was like a meter away. He had he taken another step, I would have drilled him, and he was a monster. So I'm going to definitely go back there, and I'm gonna get him one day, I think.
For those people who haven't seen the kind of bush there, who are used to hunting like stags up in Scotland, this is thick stuff.
Yeah, it was pretty thick stuff. And
it's just why something can be so close to you and you can't get the shot off.
Yeah, yeah.
Crazy.
No, that was an awesome time with those guys. And yeah.
There was something, I had something on the top of my head there that I was going to ask you. Now it was something you had said, but now it's gone. But let's talk slightly more. Oh no, I tell you what it was. It was about the 1080. Now Josh mentioned that we had Josh James on, and he mentioned it briefly in the long interview we did with him. And we were supposed to be, because they've just done a whole other a big campaign very recently with 1080 drops. He is going to come back on, but it's just been difficult sort of tying it in with the time zones and stuff.
Yeah, he's a busy man.
Very busy man, and very, very, very popular man. Very cool guy, actually.
Yeah, he is.
But what's your take on it? And maybe you could just give a little bit of background for people who don't quite understand why the hell they're dropping poison.
I'm definitely not as far into 1080, the thing with 1080 as Josh is, but if he only touched on it, listened to the podcast as well, I can't remember. But thing is, the Department of Conservation, they do the droppings to kill possums, which is the reason for the droppings, and that's because they, one, carry TB, tuberculosis, and secondly, because they feed on particular leaves and destroy the fauna, and I think maybe it's an under. I think they've overestimated what impact the possums have, and I think that they're also using the possums as an excuse to also wipe out deer, because deer obviously also have an impact on the environment. And So they wipe out big populations of not only deer but also native birds and dogs when they get close to farms. That happens as well. People's dogs die, horses die. I'm not sure of the pollution of waterways. Not really sure if the poison is actually sort of washed out and not effective anymore when it gets into water. But there are different problems with the 1080. And I mean, they're saying they're doing the droppings to preserve the fauna and the native wildlife, but at the same time they're killing the native wildlife with this poison. So I think what I actually thought of was doing, you know, resettable traps, and now I see they're actually producing them, and that's awesome. So they can actually put traps up in the tree now, put some food in there, and the possum's going to go up, and it's going to just work like a mouse trap. I think possum dies, falls down, and another possum goes up, and so it's just resettable trap. And I think it works very well, but I don't know the labor intensity. It's a big subject, and I don't want to go to any conclusions because I'm not really into
That's fair enough.
Subject that well.
But I do know from what I've read, and certainly from what you see Josh post on social media, is that it's a pretty horrific death.
And the death is horrible. Yeah. That's the main thing. I mean, this is a horrible death. They eat the freaking poison, and they just go down with, you know, stomach pains and froth and cramps. They just lie down and froth for hours before finally expiring, you know. Horrible death. And it happens to dogs, horses, and native animals as well. Birds, yes. I mean, I've been into areas where I've literally heard no bird. It's just a dead forest.
Really?
Yeah, it's scary, man.
That is very strange. That must be surreal.
Proper scary, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, so, I don't know. I find it quite a sad thing. And yeah.
I mean, I don't know if in places, you know, those big culls of animals are necessary. I mean, they could probably hire hunters, or I don't know if the efficiency of hiring hunters anymore. But
because they used to do it loads, didn't they?
They did, yeah. And they probably could do as well. I'm not sure what they.
We'll cover it again, I think, in some detail. Yeah. But it's just good to get that. Well, firstly, just remind people that it's going on, because, you know, look, I think New Zealand, although I've never been there, my brother's been there, so he could speak if he was here today. But, you know, he's spent a bit of time in New Zealand with my cousin. You know, it seems like a fantastic country, but it's sad that there are these things going on. But it's held up as sort of this kind of all green country. But then you got a government poisoning its population. Yeah.
No, it's horrible.
Which is horrible. Yeah, it's not.
There's got to be other solutions to it.
I'm not sure what your take on this is, but I know that the one thing that maybe not wanting to make this a negative thing about New Zealand at all, but the one other thing that comes up there that you see quite a lot on, like if when you see pictures of people, especially shooting stags, which, you know,
you're huge stags,
about. Yeah, exactly, yeah. I mean, these big daddy stags with like a million and one points, and you know, close to new world records. In fact, my one friend, he's just come back. He's just been there for 6 months, and he was working on a farm there, on a dairy farm. And some sort of connection through the guy who owned the farm, he got to see what is potentially going to be the next world record stag, because they know that from, what you know, the antlers that are cast the year before.
Yeah.
And that industry there of big stags on private land is something that I suppose is kind of akin to what people would know as sort of caged hunting or canned hunting in Africa. Yeah. I mean, it's not. It's kind of similar. I mean, what have you seen of it, and what's your kind of thoughts and opinions on that?
Look, it is what it is, and I don't blame any hunter for going in a pen and hunting a stag in a pen or in a fenced off area. It is what it is, but I think I'm a hunter as well. But for non-hunters, it might seem very, you know, distasteful. Could you call it, you know? If they know that, oh, the hunter's just going in and he's in it for the trophy, you know what I mean? That's what sort of puts non-hunters, if you could call them, you know, that's sort of what put those people off it. And I think it could be sort of a downfall to some of the hunting, actually, but it is what it is. I see it as what it is, and it's going in and it's taking out an animal ethically, completely, 100% ethically. and utilized in the meat, there's nothing wrong with it. That animal has lived a good life, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. I think it's a way better way to produce meat or animals and have people hunt, have a successful hunt, you know. They can have the experience of walking around hills and maybe if you're not as fit or whatever, what do I know? You get a successful hunt, and you don't have to go out and struggle for days in the bush. I mean, whatever you get your rush out of, I mean, you can definitely get an awesome hunt, even though it's an offence. And I don't blame anyone for doing it.
We probably should say that it's not like it's the size of a garden. I mean, we're talking like maybe 1,000 acres, 1,500 acres.
It is hunting, and you can hunt for days without finding the right animal, probably. I mean, you will see stags, probably. All depends. I mean, it varies, of course. But, yeah, it is hunting still. Well, I mean, you know that the animal is there, and so that's one factor taken out of it. But I mean, that's also part of a difference between bow hunting, I find, especially traditional bow hunting, to rifle hunting, is once a hunter grows with experience, they want to challenge themselves more, you know, and that's where trophy hunting is probably misunderstood a bit. I think trophy hunting is also, well, it is, you know, the hunter trying to challenge himself. He could have taken out a lot of deer that were younger, but he wants to pursue, he wants to find that animal that's lived long, and that's his challenge, you know. My challenge is getting close to any animal, you know. So that's my prioritization towards, say, instead of being a trophy hunter, you know. So any animal will be any deer will be an absolute trophy to me with the bow, whereas a rifle hunter needs to shoot something big, because he would have then worked his ass off to find that big trophy, whereas I would have just worked my ass off to find a deer, you know, or get close to a deer. So that's sort of, yeah, I think trophy hunting might be misunderstood. Like, it's just setting up a challenge for yourself, really.
Yeah, no, I think what you were saying about the, you know, the situation there with the really big deer in New Zealand is an interesting one, because what you say is absolutely correct. You know, the animals are still, if you compare it to sort of intensive agriculture, they're still having a much better life. The meat is still being eaten. They are still being hunted ethically, and they die in exactly the same way as something that had been 100% wild and completely free roaming over a million hectares. But it just so happens that, yes, okay, they know
they die a better death than what wild animals do.
Oh yeah, in the wild, yeah, if they're not
die of starvation and freaking breaking a leg or whatnot, you know.
I suppose you kind of touched on it, but it is the actual hunter's sort of personal ethics choice about what they want to do. And so for me personally, it doesn't interest me in the slightest going to go and shoot something which is, you know, going to be a new world record, especially if it's been bred in those circumstances, yeah. You know, where they're adding minerals and licks and supplementary feed so that they can grow these big heads, because that's the only way that you grow those big heads.
Yeah,
I know that you see pictures sometimes and it does make me chuckle, and I think this is a slightly distasteful part of the industry where they say, you know, wild stag, and I look at that thing and I think, you guys are lying through your teeth. That is no wild stag.
And I don't, you know, I've seen so much of it. I don't give a freaking, you know. I know what it is, and it is what it is.
Yeah.
And I don't really care. I've heard stories of people, and you would have probably too, you know, hunters being flown up on the side of the mountain and you know, being dropped off, probably chasing the tar around the mountain, and then the hunter getting dropped off and shooting the tar, or the guide ends up shooting the tar, and then they fly the helicopter over to the tar, grab the tar, fly it up on top of the mountain, and they take a picture, you know. And that's not hunting either, but, I mean, so that's probably more disgraceful, I think, you know. That's hunting for just to get an animal and to say, oh, I've done this and that. It is, you know, some people use it as a boast, to have something to boast about, but I know what it is, and that animal has still been taken to be honest, that animal has died quickly. And it's just the person that's using it for something that it's not.
Yeah.
And you can say what you want, but that animal has died quickly. And
yeah, yeah. No, you're absolutely right. And, you know, this is something we've tried to explain normally in reference to hunting in Africa, and for maybe people's individual reason for wanting to kill an elephant or kill a lion. It's exactly the same situation here where you're talking about a tar or a big red stag.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, there will be a big industry around there. It's maybe a little bit different in New Zealand because you've got this sort of conflict with the government actually poisoning their populations of game. But there is still an industry here, and certainly on private land, they are managing the ground and the animals that are in it. Yeah. And if the government keeps on going the way that they're going, there might not be all that many animals left in the actual in the wild ground, which is maybe another thing that I just thought of the top of my head there.
Yeah.
So the sort of the private ground might be the sort of the safe haven for the game that's there. So does it really matter does it really matter to the animal the reasons for the person pulling the trigger? It doesn't matter how.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't matter. But I mean, you or I, as what I would like to think as, you know, sort of hunters in the kind of truest sense of what we want to achieve from it, you know, I don't think that that's a good way. You know, that doesn't interest me in the slightest. If I'm going to go and take something off the top of the mountain, I'm going to go to the top of the mountain, I'm going to carry it off myself.
Mm.
Because that's, for me, I would feel like I had sort of cheated and it had been incomplete, and I wouldn't see the purpose in doing it myself.
Well, you see that in all walks of life, people taking a shortcut, whatever, and trying to be something that they may not be, you know, and I don't care, you know.
Yeah. I suppose that the caveat to all of that is that if you were doing sort of mass population control, like that was your job, population control through culling a certain species, a certain number of species, or you're harvesting meat from a population, then in that terms, it doesn't really, you're going to use the most efficient method possible, which might involve helicopters and taking all of the shortcuts because there's time frame and everything. So I don't want people to think from our conversation there that I'm not going to speak for you, but that I'm objecting to that. It's just that from the sort of personal hunter perspective, it all depends on what you're doing it for. There are reasons for a lot of things.
Yeah. I absolutely, what triggers me most is the stalking part of the hunt, you know.
Mm.
Once you've gotten close enough to where you're actually in the proximity of the animal and you're fighting against the absolute keen senses of that animal, and you're winning it, you know, and you're getting in there, you're getting into 15 meters of a stag that, or 10 meters, I got into 10 meters of a freaking Samber stag, you know, and they're so switched on. And that was just, you know, that was just such a big win for me, you know.
No, you got the stag, didn't you?
Hey, yeah, I got the stag.
Yeah, because I saw a picture of it. Maybe talk me through that.
Yeah, that wasn't the particular stag I was talking about, but he was, that was going, I was after having taken down the Samber hind, I drove north. I got the opportunity to hunt some private land further up north for rooster deer, and I ended up, drove for a long time. I ended up going out camping, and I only had a few days because you know, the forecast said that the rain was going to come pouring down, and this is the story of the rooster stag, not the Samber stag, and the rain was going to come pouring down, and I did a run for it anyways, and the first day going out, I saw prints, didn't see any stags. The second day I walked out, and it was just it's just a beautiful day, and I could see fresh prints, and I just stood still and scanned the area, and started walking again, and stood still again, looking, and all of a sudden this stag just starts thrashing a bush. You know, I could just see antlers, and he was just going at it. And this was in the beginning, you know, when they start rutting, just before the rut, so they start marking trees and marking the area. And my heart just started pumping, man. And he walked out to probably 25 quartering away, and I just let him walk. And I waited a bit, and I started scanning the area for hinds, and I couldn't see any, so I followed along. And all of a sudden, I found him again. He was threshing another tree, and I spotted another hind, so I had to sit back. And she luckily walked off, and I could just sneak right into her. I probably got to 30 meters of the stag. And I think he must have caught a bit of movement, because he would have seen a bit of movement. He had put his head up, just looking, And I was like, I think it's over, man. It's going to be over. And then he just started, you know, threshing bushes again. And that was just so lucky. I was lucky he was busy. And I was like, he ended up being on his back legs, just absolutely killing a tree. And I was like, oh, this is the best footage ever. I need to get it. But then I was like, you got to make the move now, you know. So I walked in and I got to probably 17 meters and I was trying to push closer and I was like, what are you doing? Just stop. It's a big target. You know you can hit, you know. And I stopped and he was perfectly broadside looking away and I just sunk the arrow straight into his chest, you know. And that was so crazy awesome as well. And I started actually crying a bit again because, I finally got this fair guy I've been working my ass off for.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And how did he go far after you let the arrow loose?
He went 50 meters and then he just stood puffing. And he was, I could tell he was bet. And I was just, why is he not going down? It actually took longer than I expected. But then he laid down behind a couple of trees and I knew he wasn't getting back up again. All of a sudden, like a minute after, he just took off and then he vanished into some small bushes. And I was like, I walked to the other side. I couldn't see him running out, so I figured he was going to be there. And I didn't want to push it if it was a bad shot. I started doubting myself because he didn't go down straight away. I started doubting myself and I backed off. And I actually stayed away. I packed down camp. I stayed away for 3.5 hours before getting back just to be sure not to push him out, you know. Mm. Came back and he was dead right where he, you know, had gotten up. So he would have been dead straight after. And it was a perfect arrow, taking out both lungs. And, yeah, that was awesome.
Amazing.
It's a crazy hunt, yeah.
Is there's no video out for that yet, is there?
No, there's nothing yet, but it's gonna come up and yeah.
Well, just while we're mentioning that, if people wanna follow you and what you're doing, where's the best place to do that?
Well, it's probably I'm gonna link to all films on. I'm doing YouTube videos, so you can look me up on YouTube. Yep. But it's probably the easiest to go into Orskov Hunting on Facebook. So Orskov Hunting. And I'm linking all my YouTube films in there and posting up photos and small stories and whatnot. But I've got the YouTube channel. You should be able to find it somewhere. Yep. There's a link in there.
We'll stick the links up anyway.
Yeah.
So what's next for you? Obviously, you're busy studying right now. You got to get that under your belt. But what's your plan for the next few years? Yeah. Obviously, you got to hunt. I mean, if you don't hunt, it's not you.
That's true. It's a good question because when I got back, I was like, we watched that footage together of Nikolai shooting that big moose, you know, on that epic adventure you'd been on up in
Sweden,
up north. And I was like, when he went, I didn't even feel jealous, you know. Usually, I'd be like, I wish I was going, you know, but I didn't feel that, you know. When I came back, I was like, I was drained from energy, you know. It wasn't natural, you know, to hunt half a year straight almost. So, but now I'm slowly starting to get it back, or I am getting it back now, you know. The itch is definitely getting back, and I've actually been riding with a guy from the States, Oregon. And he's we've been riding for the past I think probably a year now. Brendan, his name is, and so he said that he in the first message he actually invited me over to hunt elk in the States, and so I think that's going to be my next mission. And he's going to New Zealand in a couple months, and he's going to take my car in New Zealand, and I'm going to point him into. I'm actually going to point him into, and this is the first time I ever do this. I'm going to point him into the spot where Espen and I shot our big stags, and he's going to bring his rifle there, and he's going to hoping that he's going to take a stag out of there. I know that a lot of New Zealanders know of the area as well, so it's going to be a tough hunt as well. But he's going to go hunt, and I'm going to send him in for tar and chamois where I know there's good places. And then I'm thinking that's the next thing, that probably hunting elk in September in Oregon. Wow. With Brendan.
That's going to be something else.
Yeah. Yeah, we actually had our first Skype conversation just last night talking about hunting. And, it's pretty crazy what the internet allows you to do, you know.
Yeah. And connect with people all around the world.
Up with like-minded people, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's fantastic. Well, I hope that comes off, and when it does, you just got to promise me that you can come back onto the podcast to talk about your experience in the States.
Yeah,
that's gonna be something else.
I've been wanting to hunt elk for quite a while,
and with a recurve as well.
Hey,
with a recurve as well. Is that how you're gonna hunt
it? Yeah, that's with the butt. Yeah, he's on the compound, and I'm on the recurve, and yeah, we're gonna film it and hunt the hell out of it. Yeah, we're probably gonna go for, I don't know, 3 weeks full on. He's gonna do a few probably a week before I get there. Yeah, and then we're just gonna go full on and hopefully get some bulls bugling.
Magic. Yeah. Ulrik, it has been absolutely fantastic speaking to you, and I could probably spend another hour talking stories, but all good things must come to an end, and I got to save a reason to have you back on again, so I can't use up all your stories in one podcast. So a little tantalizing bit for our listeners is that we will probably have you on again pretty soon, and you'll be able to hear more of your stories. And I'm sure that my brother and I, we've got some work on in Denmark at some point in the next couple of months, so we'll try and we'll try and tee up then.
Definitely, that'd be awesome. Let me know when you get here and we'll sort out a beer and whatnot.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
stay well, and I hope the rest of the studies go well for you, and September comes around probably far quicker than you realize, and that goes
mate,
well.
I'm looking forward so badly. Yeah, I'm ordering a bugle, and I'm just gonna watch videos of bugling and tactics, and yeah, oh,
get that call on. We had when David was on a while ago, he was giving, in fact he was talking about the trip to New Zealand and the sort of kind of the spiritual aspect of that trip for him personally, and he was giving us some he was calling stags over the podcast. It was brilliant. Absolutely fantastic. And I've been lucky enough to see the film that you were talking about.
Yeah.
Although it's not out yet. And yeah, you get that in there, and that kind of rawness that he was explaining there, and the connection was fantastic. So you must let me know when that is out for public consumption, so that we can share it with our listeners.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, mate. It's been really good talking to you. And yep.
Have a good rest of your weekend.
You too, mate.
Thank you very much for listening. We will be back again in 2 weeks' time.
I think we pretty much exhausted you with everything we wanted to say at the start. But I just want to remind everybody that to check out the link in the description for the video where Ivan Carter is telling everybody about the chimpanzee sanctuary. And as we said at the start, to try and raise a bit of money for them, well, first of all, we would like you to go and check it out and maybe donate. But if you want to go and buy something from our shop, from the website, thepacebrothers.com, in the next 2 weeks, we are going to give 15% to the charity through to Ivan. So that is that's a pretty good reason. You get something in return as well.
Mm-hmm. So I think... Well, I think the next show could be stuff from Iwa. It might not be.
Maybe. No, maybe. I don't think it will be. No.
Okay.
So it'll be 2 shows' time. We'll be bringing you live conversations from the Iwa Outdoor Classic. But the next one, I'm not quite sure what it's going to be. We've got a couple of people, so it depends who we get to interview first will be the next podcast. So it's a surprise.
Who's this show brought to us by?
This show is brought to you by the Scottish Association for Country Sports. We mentioned them at the start, as we do with every podcast, and particularly this week. Don't forget to check out the discounts that they have on 3 of the major car manufacturers in the UK. As Daryl said, it shouldn't be the reason for joining a shooting organization. It should be to support the good work that they do, but it is a rather nice bonus.
It is.
So give their office call if you want to know a little bit more about the discounts. Certainly there's enhanced discounts on Toyota until the end of March, and the savings, because I've seen them, are pretty substantial. So I would, if you're in the market for a new car, give them a call first. If you're a member or if you're thinking about joining and want to know more about the discounts, then give them a call.
That should,
That's us.
It'll make your day.
I think it will.
Yeah.
You will hear from us in 2 weeks' time.
You will indeed. Remember, I forgot to say, remember, we are on Facebook. And thank you to the 10,000 people that have now started following us on Instagram.
Yeah, it's been crazy, actually. The Instagram followers have just started to go through the roof.
So big thumbs up for all the people that follow us on Instagram. Thank you very much.
And just very lastly, to sign off, if there's anything that you, our listeners, would like to hear from us, then just get in contact, because
loads of you do it already.
Yeah.
And it works. There's so many emails that we've been sent, and we've either are questions that they would like answered, or they're wanting stuff on the show, and we make it happen.
And don't forget to enter this week's competition, which is to win a Surefire G2X Pro Torch.
No excuse. No excuse. Enter.
It's a Facebook competition, but as we said, if you don't use social media and you want to enter, then just simply send us an email, podcast@paceproductionsuk.com, and we'll enter it.
Yep. Join.
Thank you.
That's it. Thank you.
That's awesome.